When the leaves start rustling, the pumpkins start plumping, and the scarecrows start crowing, you heed the call of fall. Because you eat, sleep, and drink pumpkin at Dunkin'. So, take your pick of pumpkin with delicious muffins, munchkins, and donuts, and pair them with a classic pumpkin spice signature latte or the ultra-smooth pumpkin cream cold brew, topped with pumpkin cream cold foam. All so you can fall harder. America runs on Dunkin'. Price and participation may vary. Limited time offer. Terms apply.
If you look for it, every day has cause for celebration. Celebrate a friend for their promotion, baby, wedding, life thing. Celebrate yourself for keeping the couch warm. It's no easy feat, especially if it's a big couch. Or maybe you just want to celebrate living in 2022 where you can get beer, wine, and spirits delivered from Drizzly in under 60 minutes without leaving said couch. So download the Drizzly app or go to drizzly.com. That's drizly.com. And get your favorite drinks delivered today.
Hello, thanks for tuning in to another episode of NCIA's Cannabis Industry Voice on Cannabis Radio. I'm Bethany Moore, the Director of Communications at the National Cannabis Industry Association. Today, I'm excited to return to the podcast after a brief break. We had lobby days in Washington, D.C. in September, and it was honestly amazing. So I'm going to be speaking with some of the attendees. And today, I'm speaking with a couple of members from a very special group that joined us, the Veterans Action Council. So today, I'm speaking with Etienne Fontan and Michael Krawitz. So Etienne is the vice president and co-owner of Berkeley Patients Group, or BPG. It's the nation's oldest continually operating medical cannabis dispensary, established in 1999. Etienne has an extensive background as an engaged activist and public speaker seeking to make cannabis legal and safe. Starting in 1993, he was a director of the Cannabis Action Network. He's an Army combat veteran of Desert Storm and served in the West Virginia Army National Guard. He now lobbies nationally and internationally on veterans' behalf for the use of cannabis and natural medicines. He's also a founding board member of NCIA, starting in 2010 when the organization was founded. He is also founder of the Veterans Action Council and sits on the advisory board for Battle Brothers Foundation. My other guest, Michael, is a disabled United States Air Force veteran and serves as executive director of Veterans for Medical Cannabis Access, as well as other board and advisory roles. He successfully negotiated the first ever VA medical cannabis policy in 2010 and has since overseen the WHO process in Geneva and then the United Nations process on the WHO cannabis recommendations, ultimately removing cannabis and cannabis resin from the single convention treaty most dangerous drug category. He also serves on the Virginia Cannabis Public Health Advisory Council. It's an honor to have both of you on the show today, and my pleasure. Welcome to the show.
Thank you, Bethany, and thank the NCIA for having us today.
Thank you.
Absolutely. So let's kick it off by learning more about both of you. Let's start with a little bit more about your military background and any other professional experience you had prior to getting involved in anything cannabis related. Let's start with you, Etienne.
Well, I joined the West Virginia Army National Guard to basically get an education as a GI Bill. I came from a poor family, and so I didn't have access to that secondary education. So I joined the military to do so, and inadvertently found myself in one of the finest artillery units in the United States military, so good so that for Operation Desert Shield and Desert Storm, I was attached to the French Foreign Legion as their artillery support. So the 1st West Virginia was also the oldest unit in the United States that was organized back in 1735. So it's the oldest continuously active regiment in the U.S. Army. And so, when I joined them, it was during 88. So the Eastern Bloc was coming down, and I was not anticipating to find myself in combat. But 2 years later, I found myself on the front. And then when I was going through my service, I sustained injuries and then was diagnosed with Gulf War syndrome, which was exposure due to nuclear, biological, and chemical warfare. And it unfortunately attacked my nerves. And I was speaking with a military physician about getting off the morphine they had me on. And he recommended me hashish. And that has since sent me down a 30-plus year journey that brings me here today.
Wow. Thank you for sharing that experience. Michael, how about yourself? What's your background and experience before getting involved in the cannabis movement and industry?
You know, I always think that if the universe had worked out a little differently, maybe I would have been on a different path. Maybe if I was brought up on the West Coast, I might have gone into the cannabis movement instead of the military. But you know, these are choices. You make life choices and paths. I went into the Air Force right out of high school. I actually had a career path. I was getting ready to get actually retrained into the Army. I was going to trade my three stripes for training and then become a warrant officer and learn how to fly a helicopter. But in the 4 years that I was in the Air Force, I worked on electronic warfare gear. I was an electronic warfare systems technician. Now, I was in peacetime. I kind of feel strange every time I say that. My brain reels off because, yeah, it was peacetime, but it was one of the high points in what they call the Cold War. It was pretty intense for peacetime. And I worked on B-52 bombers. And that was the planes that I worked on the electronic warfare gear on. That gear, what it did was it made the plane invisible to radar for a second or whatever it needed to allow it to get through barrages of ground fire that might be aimed at trying to take the plane out of the sky while it was delivering its payload. So I was one of the technicians helping to keep the machine of war going in a way. I became injured when I was over there in Guam, USA, and I got injured pretty badly. I was getting ready to do a big world tour on my way to another duty station. Instead, I wound up spending a couple of quality months in Tripler Army Medical Center in Hawaii recovering. But that was a major turning point. Instead of, as I was saying, going off and getting retrained and becoming a helicopter pilot, all of a sudden I became a patient and you had to deal with a whole new universe. And I came to learn about cannabis as a medical patient, as a medical marijuana patient. But I always kind of talk about the genesis that I went through, because I think a lot of people in my age bracket or older looked at cannabis one way as a kid and then slowly looked at it a different way as a patient, a genesis of understanding that it was a medicine, mostly when you run out of medicine and you realize how much your pain and issues come back. But I actually got a prescription after I left the service and found cannabis helped me put away a lot of the pain medications and a lot of the other pills and made it very effective, the pain medication that I was still taking, and allowed me to function. So, you know, I'm retired now, but cannabis definitely has been an important part of why I'm a functional retiree and able to do some of this stuff.
Wow. Yeah, thank you both for sharing your stories about your military experience and how it brought you to cannabis, which brings me to the Veterans Action Council, the organization that NCIA is friendly with, and we invited a contingent to join us in Washington, D.C. for our most recent lobby days in September here in 2022. We hadn't been able to go back to DC since 2019 because of the COVID-19 pandemic. So this was a really wonderful time to come back together with, you know, 100 NCIA members and the Veterans Action Council. So in these next couple minutes here before our next commercial break, let's talk more about the Veterans Action Council and its purpose. Etienne?
The Veterans Action Council is an all-volunteer group of international veterans. We're venerated professionals in our respective fields, and we're committed to setting higher standards of care for veterans community nationwide. We're all equals. Each member brings a unique perspective and a wealth of lived experience, both in and out of service. Our mission is to ensure safe and affordable access to natural medicines and alternative therapies for veterans. We're doing what we feel needs to be done. We're working to provide safe and affordable access to natural medicines and alternative therapies for veterans. And so we started off as a buddy check originally when COVID started. And as we started talking and gathering, we realized that we were all pretty amazing cannabis all-stars in our own neck of the woods. And when we started to talk about our Rolodexes, we realized we were quite powerful. And so we started volunteering, and now we have multiple meetings each week where we get together and we strategize. We formed a white paper, which is called our green paper, which we put out a year prior, which is basically giving a series of asks. It's actually sandwiched in between Robert Randall, who was patient zero, his wife, Alice O'Leary Randall, who survived. Robert has passed. He sued the federal government for access to medical cannabis. And this was the filing that they had submitted to the Clinton administration. So this is also how far it's taken the administration to do anything at the federal level. So at the back end, it is sandwiched with the work that Michael Krawitz and others have done at the international level that changed international law at the World Health Organization and at the United Nations, allowing for medical cannabis to be accessible. So one of the things we were there talking about is trying to get the United States back in compliance with the international law that they're out of compliance with, the same law that the DEA had beat us in the cannabis industry over the head, or anybody who tried to petition for rescheduling, saying that we can't because we're now part of this treaty. Well, Michael changed that treaty, and it is now legal around the world. So we wrote to the United States Attorney General's office asking them to come into compliance with the federal law. So we were making our people aware and our constituency on the Hill that medical marijuana should be legal currently in all 50 states and territories and federal properties, and could be done so by the U.S. Attorney General's office. So it was rather interesting to hear our language come from the President of the United States when he directed the HHS and the U.S. AG's office to look at and into rescheduling cannabis.
Right, right. We have to jump to a commercial break, but Michael, is there anything else you'd like to add about your experience with the Veterans Action Council?
I just think it's great to have a group like this. It's not really an organization. We're not working for funding. We're working for the goal. And if you work in cannabis activism, you know how unusual it is for a stakeholder group to kind of come and represent itself. But that's what we're doing.
Wonderful. All right, let's take that commercial break, and then we'll be right back to dive into how your lobbying experience on Capitol Hill went. Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
NCIA's Cannabis Industry Voice will return once we give a voice to our sponsors.
Are you ready? Amazon Warehouse Hiring Day is coming on October 26th. Amazon will host live hiring events in your city to showcase all the reasons why this Amazon warehouse is the place to work. Things like competitive pay, great benefits, and so much more. Drop in for some swag, bring a friend, and you could even walk away with a job. To find an Amazon Warehouse Hiring Day event close to you, visit amazon.com/hiringday. That's amazon.com/hiringday. Amazon is an equal opportunity employer.
When the leaves start rustling, the pumpkins start plumping, and the scarecrows start crowing, you heed the call of fall. Because you eat, sleep, and drink pumpkin at Dunkin'. So, take your pick of pumpkin with delicious muffins, munchkins, and donuts, and pair them with a classic pumpkin spice signature latte or the ultra-smooth pumpkin cream cold brew, topped with pumpkin cream cold foam. All so you can fall harder. America runs on Dunkin'. Price and participation may vary. Limited time offer. Terms apply.
All right. We're back on NCIA's Cannabis Industry Voice on Cannabis Radio. I'm your host, Bethany, with NCIA. And I'm talking with Etienne Fontan and Michael Krawitz from the Veterans Action Council. So as I mentioned before the break, we were in D.C. recently in September for NCIA's 10th annual Cannabis Industry Lobby Days. So we were mostly talking to congressional offices about the Safe Banking Act, which has passed the House of Representatives, what, six or seven times now, Section 280E of the IRS tax code that's crippling cannabis businesses, and some of these bigger comprehensive reform pieces like the CAOA, the MORE Act, and so on and so forth. What were the Veterans Action Council members more focused on during these meetings with members of Congress, and how were you received during those meetings?
We reached out to the NCIA when we were looking at coordinating directly, and they suggested that we could have a mission to accomplish on Capitol Hill that their regular members could not do. So they asked us to meet with the Republicans and Democrats on the Armed Services and Veterans Armed Services Committees. And so 12 of us met on, sent out two teams on Capitol Hill. We had 26 meetings in 2 days.
Oh my God, that's so many.
Yes, but we were basically out on a planting seeds tour in the future regarding issues that we as a council had put together. The VAC demanded that any law set to address cannabis at any federal level should immediately include veterans' access to medical cannabis and care through the VHA pharmacy system. We also asked for a medical card designation on our VA medical cards, either a physical designation on the card or on the magnetic strip, so that we would not be arrested traveling through any of the states where it's not legal, or to travel with our medicine on federal property, which we made our senators and representatives aware that we could not do while we were meeting with them.
Wow.
We also made them aware of the current Canadian, which is oddly enough called the VAC, the Veterans Access to Cannabis Program in Canada, where if you are given 100% disability rating by the military for your service in Canada, you are then given 3 grams per day free of charge by the Canadian government that you can now order in any modality off of the National Pharmacy app on their phone. For if you want an edible, you want a joint, if you want a sublingual, you want a drink, as long as it adds up to 3 grams, it is sent free of charge to your front door within 48 hours by the Canadian Postal Service.
That's wild.
So we were making our constituency aware of that fact, and we asked specifically for a meeting to be traversed between the Canadian VHA and the U.S. VHA systems, Veterans Health Association, Administrations, pardon me, so that they could actually get into a room and talk about it. We presented them as well with our green paper, and we discussed the Mississippi Grow, which many of them were not aware that our federal government has been growing medical cannabis that they call for the past 40 plus years. We do not consider it that grade.
Right.
And then we made them aware of the international law compliance that we spoke of earlier, that the U.S. is currently not in the graces of the laws that we have chosen to abide by for decades by the DEA's own rules. Mm. So by changing the laws internationally, we made them aware that we have reached out to the USAG's office and they should be aware. One of the most interesting things that we made them aware of currently, because the people that we met with were mostly Armed Services and Veterans Committee members, the majority of the people we met with were military fellows. Fellows are people who are actual officers in service who take a year off, they don their suits and work behind the scenes in congressional offices. And since we are veterans and we asked specifically to speak on veteran services, the majority of the people we spoke with contained a fellow from the military, which were usually equivalent of a captain in rank for officers, mostly majors and higher. We made them aware that there is a TBI, which is traumatic brain injury medicine, currently available to Israeli medics that has THC in it. And that, of course, since it goes through the nose, it goes directly into the absorption and into the brain blood barrier and absorbed directly into the brain. And it can stop a traumatic brain injury from moving forward. The problem with TBIs is the swelling of the brain that happens over a few week period, and this stops that swelling. The neuroprotective properties of cannabis do so, so we're making them aware of that, as well as the U.S. patent the U.S. has had regarding medical cannabis and specifically the neuroprotective properties. Wow. The last thing we were making them aware of, which is a FOIA request. Michael Krawitz was helped change law in the VA where they could actually discuss medical cannabis, and you could actually, there's a check mark that's pointed at the bottom of your VA forms for you to check regarding your medical cannabis use. It was updated again in 2017, and so we asked specifically for that data. We put out a FOIA request in March of last year. The government told us that they were gathering that data for us, and then 2 months ago told us that the data was too large, that they were gathering it in multiple data points. And ironically, the week that we were in DC, we received a letter from them stating that there actually is no data. No data has been collected. There is no data points for us to have. So we asked these 26 meetings, these offices, if they will sign on to our appeal, because we're going to appeal this process because we want to see the data. And this data should have been collected since 2010, and it has not. And we are veterans, and this is information. We're starting to see data around cannabis come back in the form of VA studies, and so we want to see that data and where it comes from, and they're telling us it does not exist, yet we are seeing these studies come back before us, so we know they are lying. So we're going to assist and get our constituency to help us appeal that process. And then, of course, we spoke on the safe banking, et cetera, and spoke on that issues as well. So those were our specific asks. But we turned out to be interesting pawns early on, because we met first off with Senator Booker's office, and Senator Booker's office basically asked us to go forward and tell the rest of our meetings that Senator Booker is willing to sign on to Safe Banking Plus if the the research veterans component is added to the bill. And so we were rather surprised to be tasked with this, but we took it forward as well. So that was giving you the basic crux of what our meetings comprised of.
Wow. Yeah, that sounds really impactful. Michael, was there anything else you wanted to add about how your meetings went on Capitol Hill?
Yeah, I think the meetings kind of broke off two different ways. So you had offices that were currently working on cannabis legislation, in which case they were very interested in specific conversations around certain bills, as you might imagine, that are in the pipeline. And then the more conservative Republican offices that we went into, mostly they were like in cannabis 101 stage. And it was very interesting to us how many of them had been recently or fairly recently approached by their constituents in Texas or wherever saying, hey, what about cannabis? Veterans, you know, saying, what about cannabis? So this is very interesting, you know, sort of lobbying from the bottom up and the top down. But I think just a thought has occurred to me. I just feel like sharing, I guess. But in the big picture, working many years on cannabis activism, I got involved in the 90s, late 90s. It seems like there's been somewhat of a shift of tactics a couple of times. You know, we had the of course the shift when we started working on state initiatives. You know, back in the day, the cannabis movement was focusing on legal cases and working in the courts and trying to pass laws and legislatures. And then at the grassroots level, showed that initiatives could be successful. That created a whole new genre of activism that led to where we are today. I mean, a history lesson. But now in the federal scene, it seems like, okay, we haven't been able to get a singular bill through. We've been pounding our heads on these very big bills. So we'll have 15 small bills that'll fix some of the problems that you've created by not having the big bill. That's my take. And so we have the banking bill. We have the, you know, federal housing and federal, you know, research act and all these different things that are bits and pieces. We are, as federal veterans, we're federal patients. So when we go into a VA hospital, that's literally on federal property. So all the federal rules apply, including no availability of cannabis, even if that's in California or if it's in Colorado.
Right.
And that not only creates an unfair situation, but it creates an untenable situation for the doctors who have to deal with that. So, you know, the longer they put off the big bills, the more small bills they're going to have to pass, I suppose.
Yeah. Yeah. That incremental reform versus the comprehensive reform is definitely a dance that we at NCIA, we dance that dance for sure. So yeah, thanks for sharing those stories. I mean, clearly the Veterans Administration has to abide by federal law, and that's kind of where we need to move the dial entirely, so that veterans, as you mentioned, whether you're in a cannabis legal state or illegal state, you still can't, or you're not supposed to, access cannabis according to the VA. Is it true that you can lose your benefits if the wrong doctor finds out you're using cannabis?
No, I mean, it's a sticky question to answer, and I don't want to answer completely, but you know, join up with us if you need a more complete answer. But the quick answer is no, your federal benefits are secure.
Okay.
However, there are some, you know, caveats to that. The biggest problem is that, you know, how do you do it? How do you manage, if you're in Missouri, or Missouri is not a very good example, maybe Idaho, you know, if you're in Idaho in a VA facility, where are you going to get your cannabis from? Mm-hmm. Out of another state, federal and state law, you know, crossing the state lines. And then, you know, the doctors get lost in the minutia of the anti-drug campaign, which says, if you're an illegal drug user, you're not allowed to be given any narcotic medication. So
okay.
They have to stand down on that, on cannabis, and not every doctor has gotten the memo. So internally, we have trouble. How do we present this? Because I've got vets in the council that would just answer that yes, because there's so many veterans that have been mistreated because of the VA doctors not really knowing what's going on. All right, I'll finish with this. The VA policy we passed in 2010, we just literally got a VA video that told everyone, including the veterans and the doctors, what this policy was and how it works last year. It just finally came down the pipe. So that's how slow they are. And the doctors just aren't given the notice of how to follow this policy, and the veterans suffer from it.
I see. Yeah. Thanks for that clarification. Appreciate that. All right. Let's take our final commercial break, and then we'll come back and wrap up our conversation with Etienne and Michael from the Veterans Action Council. Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
NCIA's Cannabis Industry Voice will return once we give a voice to our sponsors.
There you are in the great wide open when you hear it. Dinner time. When you're hungry, you're not going to let 5,000 feet of mountain get in your way. And if they try, that's what Kia's lineup of exceptionally capable SUVs with available all-wheel drive is for. The Telluride, Sorento, Sportage, and Seltos are how you know we take this pretty seriously. The SUVs and the dinner. Hurry into your local Kia dealer today. Kia, movement that inspires.
Visit Kia.com for details. Always drive safely.
If you look for it, every day has cause for celebration. Celebrate a friend for their promotion, baby, wedding, life thing. Celebrate yourself for keeping the couch warm. It's no easy feat, especially if it's a big couch. Or maybe you just want to celebrate living in 2022, where you can get beer, wine, and spirits delivered from Drizzly in under 60 minutes without leaving said couch. So download the Drizzly app or go to drizzly.com. That's drizly.com. And get your favorite drinks delivered today.
All right, we're back on NCIA's Cannabis Industry Voice, and we have been chatting with the Veterans Action Council about our experiences in Washington, D.C. lobbying for the cannabis industry and movement. And we have just a couple minutes left here on the show, but I did want to talk about a little memory of mine from lobby days. During the press conference, we had the podium and a couple members of Congress in what's called the Senate Swamp area near the Capitol in D.C. And at one point, Etienne spoke at the podium to talk about the Veterans Action Council. And honestly, I loved what you said. It was very poetic. It was very real. And there was a sentiment about the sacrifices veterans made with their lives and how important it is for Congress to act on their behalf. I was wondering if you could share those sentiments again for the audience on the podcast.
Yes, into the speech, I basically, we demand the leadership and courage from our legislators. The same leadership and courage we were asked to show while serving our country. And those are the realities that we're trying to ask of them, to show that same courage, that same leadership that you want us, when you wanted to charge into that position. Well, we've educated them beyond what they sent us into war educating us wise. So it's now up to them to show that courage for us.
I love that. Snap, snap. Beatnik and me is digging that hard. Michael, anything you'd like to add about any other memories from lobbying with us in Washington, D.C.?
Oh, gosh, there's a whole book of memories with associated photos to go with it that I can go through. I really had kind of a life-changing week there, the couple of days we made into a week for the Veterans Action Council.
Yeah.
And I think that this is what needs to happen. I mean, this is an ongoing process of communication between the people and their leaders, between the cannabis movement and the legislature, and between veterans and the broader community. So I'm really proud to have been part of it. Very, very thankful for NCIA to, you know, sort of step up and welcome us in a proper way. And when I say a proper way, we sort of have this unwritten rule that we, you know, set up as stakeholders, as veterans coming into the space 10 or 15 years ago, that we want to help. We are natural leaders. We have great experience, but we won't be used as pawns or prop. We're not going to be brought in at the last minute to just have a veteran there. If you want veterans to participate, you need to have them structurally involved. And the NCIA, you know, brought us into the structure of this entire strategic event in a way that allowed us to play a very good and important role. And as Etienne said, there were things that we were able to do as a veterans community within this cannabis space that were not even on the agenda because it wasn't something that the NCIA really felt it was easy to do given the resources that they had. And that's what I'm talking about, is expanding the resources available to get the job done using the amazing, really, truly amazing people that are military veterans in our system.
Yeah. Oh, well, we're so grateful to have had you in DC as well. And I feel like I'd like to check in with the Veterans Action Council here on the podcast more regularly, just to hear what's going on, hear any progress and successes or challenges that you're encountering, and get more of that story from you all. So you'll be hearing from me again soon. And we are going back to Washington, D.C. in 2023 for the 11th annual Cannabis Industry Lobby Days. That event will be taking place May 16th, 17th, and 18th. And I can't wait to go back. I had such a great time with all of you as well, and really look forward to heading back to D.C. Again, thank you both so much for your time, both in Washington, D.C., lobbying with us, and today talking with me on the podcast. Where can our listeners find out more about the Veterans Action Council?
You can reach out to our website, veteransactioncouncil.com, or veteransactioncouncil@gmail.com if you want to reach out and email us. We're all volunteer. We're all equals. Just show up if you're a veteran, and it doesn't matter of what country you served in. You're welcome to join us. And thank you, the NCIA, for inviting us in May to join you again, and we look forward to joining you in D.C. for the 11th annual Lobby Days. And you should join and be with us too.
Yes. All right. So we've run out of time, but thank you again. A really great conversation. And thanks to our listeners for tuning in to another episode of NCIA's Cannabis Industry Voice. Until next time.
The The opinions expressed on this CannabisRadio.com program are those of the guests and hosts and do not necessarily reflect those of the staff and management of CannabisRadio.com. Any rebroadcast, republication, or retransmission of this program without proper consent is prohibited.
Are you ready? Amazon Warehouse Hiring Day is coming on October 26th. Amazon will host live hiring events in your city to showcase all the reasons why this Amazon warehouse is the place to work. Things like competitive pay, great benefits, and so much more. Drop in for some swag, bring a friend, and you could even walk away with a job. To find an Amazon Warehouse Hiring Day event close to you, visit amazon.com/hiringday. That's amazon.com/hiringday. Amazon is an equal opportunity employer.
When the leaves start rustling, the pumpkins start plumping, and the scarecrows start crowing, you heed the call of fall. Because you eat, sleep, and drink pumpkin at Dunkin'. So, take your pick of pumpkin with delicious muffins, munchkins, and donuts, and pair them with a classic pumpkin spice signature latte or the ultra-smooth pumpkin cream cold brew, topped with pumpkin cream cold foam. All so you can fall harder. America runs on Dunkin'. Price and participation may vary. Limited time offer. Terms apply.